A new kitchen countertop is always a welcome upgrade, and ButcherBlock is a great option. It's a popular DIY project, and today I'm going to show you how to install it and do it right. This kitchen is currently under a renovation, and we just got finished installing this farmhouse sink. To see that video, check out the Lowe's YouTube channel. Installing a ButcherBlock countertop can be a more advanced project than you think. With an undermount sink, you're going to have to make sure that your top is waterproof, and with a large kitchen, you may have to use several pieces. First thing to do is make a drawing of your cabinet layout. Measure along the walls on all sides, and also along the cabinet fronts. Cabinets are typically 24 or 24 and a half inches deep. Ours are just under 25 inches, so the countertop will meet the front edge and have about an 1/8 inch expansion gap along the walls. Where the wall is not even and the gap is a little larger, we're not going to worry about because we're going to be covering it with a 4 inch backsplash. Also, check the depth from the walls to the front of the cabinet doors or drawers in as many places as possible. Now that you have your measurements, it's time to come up with a plan. If you have a short, straight run of cabinets, you're in luck. You can most likely install a single length of countertop. If you have to turn a corner, you'll need to seam two pieces together. The two types of seams are butt joints and miter joints. We're installing the butt joint, which is the easier of the two. Any other seams along the top are up to you. If you have a busy kitchen and don't want to worry about a seam at the sink, you can always place it somewhere else. Some ButcherBlock will have to acclimate to the room where it's being installed. For us, we just need to make sure that we seal all the sides within 48 hours of unwrapping it. If you're going to store the block for a few days before starting this project, keep it wrapped and away from heat vents, as they can cause the wood to warp. If you have an old countertop that needs to be removed, you can back out the screws using a screw gun, or if it's glued down, you can use an oscillating tool. Now, we don't have any countertops to remove, but I am going to remove the doors and drawers so we don't damage them. For kitchens with a lot of angles or that are U-shaped, you might want to consider making a template. Using thin strips of straight cardboard or 1/8 inch paneling, set the pieces in place over the front of the cabinets to mark the front edge. Make sure they're even along the front. Temporarily mark the back too. Next, with the pieces cut to the depth of the countertop, set them perpendicular to the front edge. You can secure them with hot glue. Creating templates for each run of cabinets will allow you to see where the seams need to be placed and if the countertop needs to be scribed along the wall. Then lay the templates on top of your ButcherBlock to mark the cuts. If you have a farmhouse sink, you'll need to make some reference marks for the cutout. Mark the center of your sink on the wall. Also mark the center on the front of the sink and transfer the interior basin walls to the apron front using a framing square, just for reference. Now it's time to cut our ButcherBlock. We're going to cut our pieces one at a time and check the fit after each cut. Our countertops have an eased edge. At the joints, I'll cut off this rounded edge to create flat seams. I'm going to start with the corner piece first. Since our corner cabinet is a little bit deeper than the standard countertop depth, I'll cut down a larger kitchen island piece to fit. Mark the length on top. Use a saw guide to create a straight cut. These are handy tools. Apply painter's tape before cutting to prevent the wood from chipping. Measure the distance from the saw shoe to the side of the blade and transfer that to the ButcherBlock. The blade should cut into the excess side of the line. Secure the guide to the top, start the saw, and make the cut. I'll rotate the piece and cut the adjacent side to fit. Set the corner piece in place and make sure the front edge is where you want it. Clamp it if possible. We'll round off this part of the cut edge later. Now set the next piece on the cabinet over the sink. Line up the front and keep it tight against the corner piece. For the sink cutout, transfer the center mark on the wall to the ButcherBlock. Also transfer the marks on the front of the sink if needed. Next, I'll use a combo square to get the distance from the front of the countertop to the cabinet face and transfer that to our top. We'll need that to line up our sink template. Our sink template has two options for the countertop reveal. We're going with no reveal. Cut out the template and line up the center mark from the wall. Also, line up the countertop depth mark and trace the template. Drill starter holes with the hole saw at the corners. This radius is about 2 inches. Next, set up the straight edge to cut along the lines. Make sure the blade's to the excess side of the line and that you stop just short of the starting hole. For the backside line, line up your saw blade, pull back on the guard, and slowly plunge it into the material to make the cut. If there's any additional material to cut, use a good jigsaw with a new blade to carefully make the cuts. When the sinkhole is cut, pat yourself on the back. Fit the top in place and check the front edge. Also, make sure the top covers the sink flange. For the last piece, measure from the middle slab to the wall along the back and the front of the cabinets. Transfer those measurements to the butcher block and cut. If the wall bows, use a belt sander to shave a little bit of the material off. Check the fit. Back at the corner, mark where pieces come together. You'll need those later for reference. Once you have a good fit, you're going to want to smooth out any rough edges. I'm using a fine grit sandpaper. You can use a sander or sandpaper to create the eased edge to match the factory edge. Don't sand off the corner reference mark yet. You'll need it for the next step, which is joining the seams. If you want to use a router to create the eased edge, you can use an 1/8 inch round over bit set to the correct depth. Test it on a scrap piece. When it looks good, run the router over the butcher block edges. Keep the butcher block on your left and move the router forward. You have several options for connecting the pieces. A pocket hole jig will create angled holes for screws to secure the pieces together. Drill the holes about every 6 inches and be sure the screws will drive into the piece with the cross grain. We're going to be using miter bolts to hold our pieces together. Lay the pieces topside down and line up the reference mark for the corner. Draw marks across each seam for the miter bolts. With a router, set a 1/2 inch straight cut bit to a depth of about a 1/2 inch. Then cut a channel into the slabs to create a space for the bolt. Move the router slowly and use a high cutting speed if possible. Create a wider area on the headside so you can fit a wrench in to tighten. Before I put everything back together, I'm going to apply a coat of sealant to all sides of the countertop. Now there's a variety of sealants available. Since our countertop's going to be exposed to water with an undermount sink, I'm going to be using a waterproof tung oil sealant. Follow the directions for your sealer. Typically, after everything's been sanded, you'll clean with a tack cloth. Then apply the sealant with a natural bristle brush or a lint-free rag. Remember to coat the entire butcher block, the top, sides, and bottom, and allow it to dry. The wood will soak up the first coat. A second coat is a good idea before you set the butcher block in place. To secure the slabs of the cabinet, use either brackets with elongated holes to allow the wood to expand and contract, or cabinet corner braces. Ream the holes to make them larger if needed. You can piece the countertop together on the cabinets, or if you have some help, you can do it before setting it in place. Next, we're applying a bead of sealant to the top of the farmhouse sink. Then we'll lower the countertop into place. We'll make sure our miter bolt channels are lined up, then tighten the bolts. Make sure the front edge lines up along the cabinets and clamp it to keep it from moving. Then secure the top in place with washers and screws through the cabinet braces and brackets. When everything looks good, cut the holes for the faucet and accessories with a hole saw. Remember to seal the bare wood. Next, install the backsplash. Just add a little bit of construction adhesive or silicone to the back and set it into place. To help hold it into place, use weights or braces extended from the upper cabinets. After the backsplash is secured, apply a few more coats of sealer to the countertop following the manufacturer's instructions. I like to use a lint-free rag for the finish coats. After the last coat of wood sealer is dried, apply silicone sealant along the walls, where the backsplash meets the countertop, and where the countertop meets the sink. Remember to add silicone around the front edge of the sink. Follow up with a smoothing tool. Once the sealant has cured, we can reconnect the plumbing. I'm going to start by installing the faucet. Just slide it into the hole and tighten the nut onto the stem, then secure it with screws. Connect the supply lines to the water valves. Our faucet has a pull-down spray head. Just connect the hose and secure the weight. To reconnect the drain, roll a piece of plumber's putty in your hands. Press it into place around the sinkhole and insert the strainer. Then using a drain wrench, secure the strainer underneath with the washers and nut. Do not over-tighten. And clean the excess putty off the top. Some cast iron sinks have thick walls and might require an extended drain flange. Next, we're gonna hook up our P-trap and our drain. I like to dry fit everything first and mark our fittings with a pen before I glue them. For PVC standpipe or waste pipe connections, apply some PVC primer to the fitting and the pipe, then apply PVC cement. Slide the fitting into place and give it a quarter turn to line up the marks. Hold it for a few seconds. Now at the sinkhole side, these slip nuts make for an easy hookup. Just make sure all your washers are in place and hand tighten. Once everything is installed, run some water to check for leaks. You might need to reset the washers and nuts if it's leaking. Finish up by applying a moisture barrier tape above the dishwasher.
And now this renovation is complete. You can see how this butcher block countertop and farmhouse sink give this kitchen a lot more personality. Now these are definitely more advanced projects, but with a little effort and the right planning, you can do it right.